Mr. Bartolomé De Las Casas. Is that your name, right?
Si, señor.
You were born in civil Spain in 1484, is that correct?
Si.
You're a Spanish Dominican Catholic priest around the age of 41.
O 40 y media.
40. English, please.
Inglese?
Si.
Alright.
After reviewing your file, your parents are merchants, correct?
Correct.
Tell me about your parents.
My father, Pedro, he was a merchant. He did very well at that time. My mother, she homeschooled me. I was homeschooled for very many years. They had a good childhood.
Tell me about your childhood.
When I was younger, I heard of Christopher Columbus's voyage to the New World. I said, that's amazing, a new world. I just wanted to get off Sevilla. I wanted to see something else in the world. In 1493, I watched him come back from his first voyage. He came back with 7 native Tainos. He gave them to the king and queen at that time. On his second voyage to the New World, my father and several of my uncles went with Columbus. They returned in 1499, and when they returned, my father gave me a little Taino, I called him Monico. But unfortunately, the next year, 1500, a royal decree made me give him back. In 1502, I went with my father on an expedition on the Isle of Hispaniola. It was an expedition of Nicolas de Ovando. And there, that was the first time I ever witnessed how they treated the natives of that land. There was such brutality.
Your view on Native American slavery was greatly influenced by a sermon. Tell me more about that.
I finally had my opportunity to go on a voyage, and I ended up in Cuba. But we had a war, and I fought in the war. And I don't know how it is now, but when we fight in wars, we take the spoils, and we make them ours. I had several slaves at that time. And doing a sermon by Fray Antonio de Matiseño, he lectured us. He exposed us for what we were. We were killing these slaves. They were actually people. People that God made, people like us, like you and me. It made me think about things in a way I never thought of them before. Because I had no problem with slaves until I saw how brutally they were treated. So I hit study, and I read my Bible, and I realized I was wrong, and I was convicted deeply, and I had to do something about it.
You witness Native Americans being slaughtered. How do you feel about that?
It still haunts me to this day. I've never seen how people could turn so evil. It was pure evil, and I was horrified at the evil. Young women and children, they were slaughtered like animals. I mean, people just stomped on corpses. No respect for the dead, as if they were not even human.
So tell me this. How do you think the treatment of the Native Americans could have been done differently?
The conditions that they lived in and the ones they worked in were just deplorable. Just deplorable, sir. Imagine having no place to sleep after you work long, tireless hours in the hot sun. Have you ever farmed for sugar before, sir? It is not easy work, and I watched them farm for hours upon hours, tireless. They had no beds and not enough to eat. So eventually I suggested that they replace the Indians with Africans.
So help me understand this. Why would you suggest African slaves as opposed to Indian slaves?
Once upon a time, there was this place called Constantinople. It was a source of where we got our slaves back then. But in 1453, the Ottomans, they sacked Constantinople, and it disintegrated Eastern Rome. We lost our source of slaves, to the Mediterranean and the Balkans. And because of that, we had turned to Northern Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, if you would. There, the practice of slavery was already intact. Matter of fact, Sicily, they had Africans there mining their sugar plantations. King Ferdinand himself, he made the comment of how Amerindians are frail, and he could have one African do the work of four Amerindians. And since they were suffering doing this, and the Africans seemed to be adjusted to the work, I made the suggestion that they use Africans as opposed to Amerindians. It was the greatest mistake I had ever made. They took the Africans, and they treated them worse than animals. And they basically traded places with the Amerindians, where the laws were only for the Amerindians. And nobody had compassion on the Africans. And I have nightmares still, sir. I have nightmares. I cannot even look at you in the face sometimes. If I could somehow undo all these things, maybe my prayers would be heard.
How did King Charles V respond to your petition to eliminate Native American slavery?
Other missionaries felt the same way I did about the mistreatment of the Amerindians. So we got together because we believed they had rights. And we tried to put the pressure on Charles V. And then eventually, yeah, I believe the year was 1531. He abolished the worst abuses of the encomienda system. After that experience, the colonists did not really appreciate us petitioning on behalf of the Amerindians. And they were quite upset. So upset that they even threatened my life. They terrorized my home. And they just beat up random Amerindians for fun. It was a tragic thing. So in 1540, I returned to Spain and joined the other churchmen and laymen to lobby Charles V for protection of the Amerindians, of course. My 40 years of experience made me an informative and convincing source for the king. So as a result, in 1542, King Charles V enacted the new laws. It was actually called the New Laws of the Indies for the Good Treatment and Preservation of the Indians.
All right. So, what is your ultimate goals for the Native American society?
In my mind, and still in my prayers today, I envision a utopian society where the Spanish could peaceably coexist with the natives. I had petitioned for a settlement in northwestern Venezuela at Cumana. I wanted to pay them wages and to have hospitals and schools, and the Spanish farmers could teach them agricultural techniques, and we can teach them about culture and teach them Spanish and convert them to Christianity.
Well, thank you, Mr. De Las Casas, for your time. You can go now.
Thank you, sir.
Next. Mr. Kim Jong-il.